Non-polluting and low-cost renewable energy right out of thin air sounds too good to be true. Well, two University of Massachusetts professors, microbiologist Derek Lovely and June Yao, an electrical and computer engineer, say it's not. Working together, they are creating energy from moisture in the air, and they explain the details to Carrie Saldo in the studio.
I think in a way it's interesting, but in another way probably it's not that, you know, astonishing, because in fact we've seen this in our daily life. So consider that in a lightning day, actually there's electricity coming from the air, right? So now in that case, actually what happens is that the positive and negative charge, they build up at the top and bottom interface of a ground. So essentially a ground basically is made of moisture. So we know that actually the ambient moisture could generate electricity in that way. This is a daily life experience. So when the charge is built up to a certain kind of threshold, they will discharge in the form of lightning. Now lightning actually is the electricity. It actually contains a huge amount of electrical energy. But the bad thing is that we don't have any way that we can utilize it. Now, I think in a way, this device, you can imagine it's a kind of miniaturized small cloud. Okay, its top interface is exposed to the ambient moisture, whereas the bottom interface is sealed. So in a way, you can imagine that the top interface, because it's exposed to the ambient humidity, the water molecule constantly bombast on the top interface. So that builds up the charge. So in a way, the top interface builds up the charge, the bottom feed does not. So it creates the same scenario as that in a cloud. It has charge separation between top and bottom. So if you connect the top and bottom, then essentially you will get electricity.
And so the wires, Professor, that you've created, these very special protein nanowires, right? Mm-hmm. They're that connection that Professor Yao was talking about?
Correct. And I didn't create them. This microbe that we discovered, Geobacter, makes the protein wires. And I think June is maybe saying that, well, this isn't that special. I think it's amazing. And nobody expected that we would see electricity produced just by putting a small device on the bench top.
I said it's amazing. Tried to clarify the mechanism that right. Actually, you know.
So perhaps he's being a bit humble,
I think. He's being a little too humble.
Yeah.
I mean, when he first told me that they had done this with the protein wires, we were, I think, both shocked.
Right.
Because really, this could have very scalable implications for creating clean, renewable energy, right? So
right.
What are you powering right now with this technology?
Currently, I think as Derek said before, you know, because initially we were limited by the production of nanowire. Essentially, we only produce small amount, so we only made a small device, which is this, I think the size of a human nail, that size. So we used that device to power up LED or LCD, certainly more than one. Actually, we connect several devices. So that is the level of power currently we are working with. But now, as Derek said, that he has lifted, overcome the bottleneck in material production. So personally, I see that we, in principle, really can scale up the technology. So you can imagine any kind of daily life electronic tools, or if we have even huge devices, we can power up even remote station. But Derek can certainly comment on the material side.
Right. So it's yeah. I would say it's really my fault that they haven't made anything bigger yet, because we were making the wires with this microbe Geobacter, which is a very interesting environmental microbe, but hard to grow in the lab. So we've recently taken the important genes out of Geobacter and put them into a microbe that's much easier to grow in mass quantities. known as E. coli. So I think we've now alleviated the bottleneck. I feel kind of relieved. And now with the ball's back in June's court to make these larger devices, and we'll see if they work.
But yeah. So how is the E. coli then being used to add into these wires, which then is used to grab this water vapor from the air and create electricity? I mean, it seems like the stuff science fiction is made of for a layperson like myself.
Sure.
It's fascinating.
Yeah. So it's they make these wires pretty much the way we grow hair. And the way we collect them is we throw them in a blender, and that chops all the wires off. And then we just strain the wires out on a filter and put them in water and give them to June, and they make the devices.
And so do you foresee a place where this technology could be used in a harmful way? If it's taking water vapor out of the air, and say you're using this at scale, right, to power huge things like buildings and homes, are we eventually going to suck all the humidity out of the air and have a problem on our hands?
No, it's not. The water molecule stays as the water molecule, so which essentially means that nothing changed. So essentially, the water molecule comes in, donate a little bit of energy, nothing changes, leaves, another water molecule comes in, so it's a cycle.
Truly renewable.
Right.
And clean.
Right.
Right.
With no foreseeable downsides at this moment? Absolutely none?
No.
Yeah.
In fact, it's green, because I think traditionally when we talk about green technology, we only focus on the energy conversion part. Essentially, nothing is produced during the conversion process. But people didn't talk about the material side, so how you make the device, like silicon technology. In fact, that the fabrication or the production of the device itself can be less clean. Let's say you produce a lot of e-waste. Now, this is a much greener technology, because one is the conversion process, as I told you before, is totally clean. The second is that the device side, the protein nanowire, essentially really is the real green material. You didn't have any toxic process involved. So Derek can comment more on this, I think.
Right. So and that's why we've been working with these protein wires, because it is such a sustainable material. We don't have to mine anything. We just grow up microbes on renewable substrates. And then there's no toxic products in the final components either. So it's biodegradable. So when your device is done, you're done with it. It can just be recycled. So it's totally green.
And so as you're both envisioning sort of how these technologies might be leveraged, where do you see it going?
Well, I'm hoping they can scale it up. And I think, I mean, Juice Lab can certainly make small devices already for, say, powering wearable electronics, biomedical sensors, for example. But I think the real excitement is in the possibility of scaling it up. By their theoretical calculations, I mean, something the size of a refrigerator could power a small home if it all scales. So to me, as really the outsider, I'm not an electronics person, to me, that's what's super exciting.